Presiding Officer, on a point of order, on the 11th of January, the First Minister announced the establishment of an internal investigation into the leaking of her parliamentary COVID statement to the press ahead of its delivery to the Chamber. And at the time, you described the leak as extremely disappointing and disrespectful to this Parliament. You also sought a commitment from the First Minister that such disrespect would not be repeated, to which the First Minister agreed. A letter from the First Minister to you dated the 7th of February confirms the conclusion of this investigation and revealed that the source of the leak could not be identified. It further revealed that the only action taken by the Scottish Government has been to send a reminder to staff on the importance of not leaking. Now, while I myself only joined this Parliament last May, my more experienced colleagues tell me this is par for the course for Scottish Government internal inquiries. So I wish to seek your opinion as Presiding Officer and as one who has now encountered leaks of this nature by the Scottish Government several times, whether you believe this investigation's conclusion is satisfactory in addressing the disrespect Parliament suffered from this leak. Would it be in order for Parliament to see an anonymised report of the investigation from the Scottish Government? If not, how can we ascertain whether further action may be required from the Scottish Parliament to unearth aspects that maybe have eluded the Scottish Government? And can I also ask you whether the Scottish Government's singular response of sending staff a reminder is strong enough to convince you that the commitment you sought from the First Minister to avoid a repeat situation is at all likely to be upheld?
Thank you. I thank Mr Kerr for his advance notice of the point of order. On the date when this incident occurred, I sought and I have subsequently received an apology and assurances from the First Minister of the Scottish Government's respect for this Parliament. I made my views on the leaking of statements on that date very, very clear. I have done so previously. I cannot emphasise enough how important it is that the place of this Parliament is respected and that all significant announcements are made here in the first instance, wherever that is possible. Now, the First Minister and I have discussed this matter, and I am content. I have made it quite clear that I do not expect any repetition of such an incident, and I am content that the matter before us is closed. But certainly, I think we'd all wish to be in a position where we're not having this ongoing discussion. We'll now move to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 3297 in the name of George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, on changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 3297 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. In order to get in as many people as possible, short and succinct questions and answers to match would be appreciated. And at question number one, I call Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken in response to the most recent recorded crime statistics showing a rise in violent crime.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Violent crime has fallen significantly in Scotland since 2006-07, including a 15% fall in homicide in 2020-21 to its lowest level since 1976. Surveys of the population also show that adults in Scotland were less likely to experience crime in 2019-20 than those living in England and Wales. Whilst that is encouraging progress, the stability in violent crime levels over recent years highlights that more needs to be done. The Scottish Government is clear that any act of violence is one too many, and we are providing 14% additional funding to the Violence Reduction Unit in 22-23 to support increased violence prevention activities. We also continue to work with Police Scotland and other partners to prevent violent crime, including through the work of Medics Against Violence and delivery of the Hospital Navigator Service.
Jamie Green.
Since April last year, latest figures actually show us that there have been 8,200 such incidents. We're now on track to reach a record high. In fact, violent crime has risen in every single year since Nicola Sturgeon was made First Minister. I've got it all here in black and white. It's not a record to be proud of, Cabinet Secretary. So can I ask you, what substantive work has actually taken place to identify What are the root causes behind a rise in violent crime in Scotland? And given that so many countries often look to us for our efforts against violence, why are things now going in the wrong direction?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Jamie Green disregards completely the point I made about the reduction to the lowest level since 1976 in terms of homicides, and also the reduction that we've seen since 2006-07. Huge reductions, substantially below those in England and Wales, such that people in Scotland are much less likely, feel themselves much less likely to become victims of violent crime. But as I've acknowledged already, violent crime is a serious issue. We have dealt with this and continue to deal with it through examples like No Knives, Better Lives, which has been deemed to be extremely successful and now copied in other parts of the UK, including London, where they've engaged with that initiative as well. The statistics on crime do show that, and this is the annual statistics, which are the most accurate records, that recorded crime remains at one of the lowest levels since 1974. Non-sexual crimes of violence fell by 4%. Between 2019-20 and 2022-21. The most recent years, of course, are affected by the pandemic, as they are in all jurisdictions, so that the fall that we saw in some crimes during the lockdown period has now been followed by an increase in some of those areas as well. We're very conscious of that and are taking a number of initiatives, both in relation to crimes of sexual violence and more generally violent crimes, as I've mentioned, through initiatives such as No Knives, Better Lives.
Jamie Green.
The Cabinet Secretary fails to accept that there's a problem, which itself is a problem, because the reality is that in 2014-15, there were 6,200 recorded cases of violent crime. In 1920, there were 9,316, a massive increase. And let's be clear what we're talking about here. Serious assaults, attempted murder, domestic abuse and robbery. These are life-changing events for the victims of those crimes. Can I ask, given that the government is considering proposals to release criminals from prison after serving just a third of their sentence, in light of these shocking statistics today, how can this be justified, Cabinet Secretary? And if it can't, will you now rule out this absurd idea?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Jamie Green misses the fact, of course, that it was the Conservatives that brought in automatic early release. Yeah. And it was the Conservatives that voted against ending automatic early release in this Parliament. Yeah. So we'll take no lessons from the Tories in relation to that. And it is, of course, the case that we will look seriously at the issues which the Conservatives, Jamie Green himself, has raised the issue quite rightly of remand in our prisons. And that's what the initiatives that we are taking forward, which are subject to consultation, seek to address. I would have hoped that we'd have some support, if not support on what we intend to do, at least some ideas from the Conservatives, what they would do in relation to remand. But it is the case, whether it's homicide, whether it's handling of offensive weapons, we've seen a massive reduction. So the number of emergency admissions to hospital due to assault with a sharp object have fallen 51% 2006-2007 till now. Now, it is important to mention that, and also the fact I mentioned previously, that people in Scotland feel less likely to be victims of crime. We can bandy around the figures from here to eternity, and we can mention different years or monthly stats versus annual stats, but the simple fact is there's less crime in Scotland than when this government came in. There's less crime in Scotland than other parts of the UK. It's felt to be that way by individuals themselves. There are more police officers who are better paid, and we've got a very good track record on tackling crime across Scotland over the past 15 years.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The statistics referenced by Mr Green show only half a picture. There are other forms of crime which are now at lower levels than in January 2020. Indeed, according to the National Statistics Recorded Crime in Scotland 2021 bulletin, recorded crime remains at one of the lowest levels seen since 1974. So, as such, how is the Scottish Government ensuring the continued reduction of crimes of dishonesty, fire-raising and vandalism that have seen an overall reduction since January 2020?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Audrey Nicholl is right, of course, that Jamie Green's question only raises a very small, partial part of the picture. Crimes of dishonesty and vandalism both decreased in the latest year to the lowest level since the 1970s, not mentioned, of course, by Jamie Green. And we are continuing to back that and other reductions in crime with our investment in frontline policing. We've increased police funding year on year since 2016-17. We'll invest £1.4 billion in 2022-23, and that amounts to more than £10 billion since the creation of Police Scotland in 2013, and has helped ensure that officer numbers are 5.4% higher than in 2007. And, of course, despite the weeks and months that we've had of Tories saying there's going to be massive increases to police budgets and justice budgets, when it came to the budget, they offered no amendment to the budget proposed by this government.
Question number two, Rhoda Grant.
to ask the Scottish Government how it is addressing the disruption to ferry services in the west coast of Scotland that has reportedly resulted in significant supply issues and interruptions to lifeline services.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
We've experienced a sustained and prolonged period of severe weather which has caused disruption in ferry services for some island communities, not just in the west of Scotland but elsewhere in the ferry network, including on the commercial strategic route to Northern Ireland. And this disruption has also occurred during the annual dry dock period and winter timetable when fewer services are running. I know that this has resulted in challenges for some communities in terms of supplies, and that creates difficulties for people and for businesses alike. But I want to assure Rhoda Grant and indeed all MSPs that we have been monitoring the situation very closely throughout each storm through regular SCORE meetings and transport resilience meetings. There's also been regular engagement occurring with CalMAC, with island local authorities, with food and drink retailers, and with community organisations through our resilience arrangements. And while we are aware that on some of our islands there has been issues with regard to perishable goods, there have been no reported cases where essential supplies are not available. This has partly been helped by CalMAC seeking to exploit weather windows where these have arisen, with the option of running amended or additional sailings if needed. They continue to engage with key stakeholders, including hauliers and suppliers, to ensure that essential goods are prioritised on these services where possible. But we will continue to monitor the situation closely and make clear our expectations of all agencies to ensure that normal service in terms of supplies is resumed at the earliest opportunity.
Rhoda Grant.
Last week, Angus Campbell, the chair of the Ferries Community Board, said, "While we are used to living with the effects of weather on ferry services, and more recently COVID, the recent extent and duration of mechanical failures on multiple vessels has led to massive disruption right across the network." He went on to say this represents a real threat to our island's ability to retain and attract people, ensure services are sufficiently reliable and at prices that permit viable communities, thereby avoid depopulation. This morning, Donald Joseph McLean of Barry Atlantic, a fish exporter, said that it is now impossible to run a business on the islands due to the unreliable ferry services. This is not just about weather. Disruption has been going on for years, yet things are simply getting worse. Can I ask the Minister if her government is trying to create a situation where communities who stood firm against it would now willingly accept privatisation?
Minister.
I thank Rhoda Grant for a supplementary question. I have to say, on the issue of privatisation, the First Minister has made her view on this very clear, one which I share regarding privatisation. That is not at all on this government's agenda with regard to our ferry services. But she does raise some really serious issues. So turning to her point, she raises the issue regarding Mr Campbell and the Community Board Chair. I'm due to meet with him in 2 weeks' time. I'm also due to meet, you might appreciate, this week with CalMAC directly. And I will be raising issues regarding resilience because it's hugely important we get this right. I'll also be meeting with a number of islands MSPs. If Ms Grant would like to meet with me on this issue, I'd be more than happy to do so. You raised a question regarding fares. My hope is that the Fair Fares Review will look to alleviate some of the concerns in this space. But again, it's something I intend to raise directly with CalMAC later this week. She spoke regarding long-term investment. I would just like to point out that the Scottish Government has announced investment of £580 million in ports and vessels to support and improve Scotland's ferry services. But on our wider point regarding the sustainability of island communities, one thing I've been quite keen to better understand is the relationship in government between myself and, of course, Cabinet Secretary for Islands, Marie Goujon. So Ms Goujon and I will be sitting down shortly to discuss that link, and particularly with regard to her point on resilience. There's an opportunity here through the island's connectivity plan, which she will know replaces the current ferries plan from next year. That's the policy we need to get in place to help ensure a sustainable future for our island communities.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me be clear. We cannot wait until next year. The fault for this chaos lies at the door of the SNP government, who have shown themselves to be incompetent. They should be protecting our island communities. Instead, they're putting them at peril. They've failed to provide tonnage, and they've also refused to employ additional crew, which would be required due to COVID restrictions, to allow CalMAC to use their full capacity, which is available. The Minister's new in post, but she does not have a period of grace because time has already run out for our island communities. Will she commit to purchase now additional tonnage and also to employ the additional crew required to use the ferries to their full capacity?
Minister.
Thank Ms Grant for a supplementary question. She asked me to commit to additional tonnage, and she will understand that I cannot give her that assurance in the chamber this afternoon because I would need to look at the costings associated with it. Notwithstanding, I recognise we have a challenge here regarding the sustainability of the current fleet, and it's important that I have the opportunity to speak to CalMac about it. She may say I don't have a grace period, but at least offer me the opportunity to raise it with them directly. But I am also cognisant of the need for speed on delivery on this point. She spoke to protecting island life. I think we do need to reflect upon what has been a very challenging period for island communities. And I think in the last week alone, we've had three named storms in Eunice, Dudley and Franklin. That has never happened since the introduction of that system that we use in terms of naming of storms. I think that's quite important. Climate change is having an impact on the way our island communities experience their ferry services. It's my job as Minister to make sure those ferry services are up to scratch. I recognise some of the challenges that Ms Grant has spoken to today. But I hope that she will understand that my job as Minister is also to listen to communities. So I'm very keen to visit our island communities, to speak to them directly and to make sure that some of the challenges she's highlighted today are dealt with adequately. And I want to give her an assurance that I will be raising a number of the points she has made, particularly on tonnage laterally there and regarding staffing with CalMac directly. And I will see what additional support in government we may be able to provide in that respect.
Alistair Allen.
I know the Minister appreciates the importance of these issues from her recent conversations with me. The lack of resilience in the network exacerbates the serious problems which people experience as a result of weather. And I could cite examples in my own constituency where food shops have had some serious difficulties. Quite aside, however, from the issue of new tonnage, can the Minister provide it to the Chamber any update on the efforts which the Government has been making to seek to charter vessels to provide more resilience?
Minister.
CMAL and CMAC continue to look for suitable vessels for charter on a temporary basis, and where this would be considered suitable, reliable, and it has to also be affordable. And I think this was the point I made to Ms Grant in my response to her. This includes, of course, though, the consideration of freight vessels for use on both the CalMac and Northlink services. I know how frustrating it can be for local communities and individuals having to face disruption, not just from weather, but also because of vessel breakdown. And while any breakdown is really unhelpful, thankfully, they are still relatively rare. But that doesn't help a community that loses its ferry service unexpectedly and sometimes without assurance on how quickly normal service can be resumed. The resilience of the fleet that Mr Allen spoke to is something we are committed to doing in all that we can. And more importantly, it's at the forefront of CMAL and CMAC's priorities. They continue to look for suitable vessels for charter on a temporary basis, where that would be considered suitable. That includes a consideration of the freight vessels that I spoke to. And again, I know Mr Allen and I have discussed this in some detail, but he knows that I will be meeting CMAC later this week. And I will be raising with CalMac the issue of replacement services and how government might be able to better support any replacement vessels in the future, because he's absolutely right to raise the resilience of the fleet in that respect.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. The problem here is we don't have enough ferries. Those ferries that we do have are too old, so they keep breaking down, and that lies at the door of CMAL. Now, we've had a report from a previous committee of this parliament saying that CMAL should be scrapped. When is the Minister going to act on that?
Minister.
I thank Mr Simpson for his supplementary. He will appreciate I've not yet had the opportunity to meet with CMAL. I am meeting CMAC this week. But let me first meet with CMAL and I can respond to him in writing in due course.
Thank you. Kenneth Gibson.
Sir, bad weather and what should be preventable breakdowns are disruptive enough to our island communities. However, COVID protocols, while necessary, have been and are very unhelpful. One crew member testing positive grinds the Lifeline ferry service to a halt. Now that the pandemic is receding, how soon will these increasingly unnecessary protocols be reviewed and, one hopes, discontinued?
Minister.
I think it's really important that we have measures in place to ensure the safety of crews and passengers. And we need to remember that even though most restrictions have been lifted, the virus is, of course, still with us. But this can also be about the time taking to mobilise relief crew should an existing crew become ill or need to self-isolate. I recognise some of the frustrations Mr Gibson spoke to this has brought, but also it's important to note that the circumstances differ from other settings as there are minimum legal crew requirements that must be adhered to. CalMAC have aligned their protocols to the guidance provided by Scottish Government. As and when guidance is changed, of course, CalMAC will review its procedures to maximise its ability to maintain sailings. But I recognise some of the frustrations that Mr Gibson has raised in this instance. And again, I give him an undertaking that I will be raising this with CalMAC when I meet them later this week.